Good afternoon, everybody. Myself, Nadeesh. I work for Java SQ team at Oracle. And today, I'm going to talk about Invokedynamic, which is a new bytecode introduced in Java 7. In this talk, basically, I'm going to cover, basically, answer three questions. Why Invokedynamic? What features it's providing? And how it's providing? If you have any question, you can ask in between itself. Don't wait till end, because if you lost something in between, I think you lost the entire time. Okay. Am I audible? Okay. JVM languages are languages which you can run on top of Java virtual machine. And to run a language on JVM, you have to produce a properly valid class file which contains bytecodes. And there are 200 plus JVM languages. And Java is the primary language which runs on top of JVM. There are other languages like JRuby, Jython, JavaScript, Groovy, Smalltalk. Most, whatever language you name, it will have a JVM equivalent version. The problem with this thing is, basically, JVM is designed primarily for Java, and there is a tight coupling between Java and JVM semantics. But semantics of other JVM languages, take example Python, its semantics is completely different from Java. For example, Python is a dynamically typed language, but whereas Java is a statically typed language. Dynamic type, in what I meant is, this is a Python code. There you can, this is a function which I define. Here, this function will take two arguments, but contrary to Java, here we are not defining any type. And the type will, the variable will assign the type at runtime. If you are passing some integer to sum, then A and B will assume, yeah, A and B will assign to the type int at the runtime. If you pass float, it will be float type. And basically that's basically dynamic typing. At runtime, you will get the type. Then other semantic differences, method invocation can be different in, semantics of method invocation can be different in other dynamic languages. For example, Smalltalk uses kind of a message passing mechanism for method invocation. And in other languages, you can add functions at runtime. This is not possible in Java. Then the another difference is scope access rule can be different from Java. For example, Java, you have a public, private, protected, default kind of access rules, but other languages may or may not have. Therefore, what I want to say is, to run a non-Java language on JVM, it has to go via wrapper or simulation layer. This wrapper layer have to simulate the non-Java language's execution on JVM. The problem with this wrapper layer is, this wrapper layer can cause performance overheads while running JVM. The performance overheads, what I meant is, this non-Java implement is, they have to write lot of extra code to make it work or make it run on JVM. Lot of code means lot of bytecodes. If you have a lot of bytecodes, JVM have to load lot of codes. It's a performance overhead. Then another pain points of this wrapper layer is, most of the dynamic languages use reflection. The disadvantages of reflection is, if you are invoking a method using a reflection, for example, some method.invoke, and if you are passing some arguments to that, the reflection, the problem with reflection is every invocation use access check. And because you can call a method from anywhere, it have to check whether at this point this class is allowed to call that method or not. Because of that point in reflection, that access check is mandatory for every invocation. Then second point is, in reflection, the method argument, basically that method.invoke will accept object as an argument. Even though your final method will accept primitive, the reflection method.invoke is accepting a object. Therefore, we have to do a lot of boxing, and in then you have to do a lot of unboxing. Therefore, there will be some n number of unused objects just for to match this reflection semantics, and it needs to be garbage collected. This is another overhead. The third and most important overhead is this wrapper layer act as a black box for the JVM. For example, just see this method. This method accepts a Boolean, and based on the based on its true or false, it's running. It branches out. And if you are always passing a false, ideal case should be, JIT should inline this thing and it should remove the else loop. But problem with this wrapper layer is, this wrapper layer may containing multiple, before reaching into the JVM call, this particular call in the non-Java languages may have to go through 2-3 layers. Because of this thing, this may not be kind of transparent to JVM. Therefore, this thing can act. I am not telling it will act. It can act as a black box, and it will affect inlining. Inlining, if it's affecting inlining, means it's affecting the performance. Basically, inlining is considered as the mother of all optimization. If it's affect inlining, means it affects performance. Therefore, what I want to convey is, to run a non-Java language, call it as a dynamic language, to run nonJVM, it has to go via wrapper layer. This wrapper layer causes performance overheads due to multiple reasons. Now, we'll see what are the bytecodes supported for method invocation in Java before Java 7. There are 4 bytecodes were there before Java 7. First one is called invoke static. It's used to call static method. For example, if you have a static method, and if you are calling using a class a dot static method, the equivalent bytecode of the above invocation will be invoke static, and it will point to some constant pool of the class file. And if it's a virtual method, I mean instance method, and if you're calling that instance method using an object, the equivalent bytecode invocation will be invoke virtual, and it will point to some constant pool of the class. The third thing is, if you're calling a method using an interface reference, for example, list L equal to new array list, and you're calling the add method using L is a interface reference. If you are calling a method using the interface reference, the equivalent bytecode invocation will be invoke interface. Then the fourth one is invoke special. It's used to call private methods, constructors, and all method all super dot methods. If you are calling a method using super dot, or every equivalent bytecode invocation will be some kind of invoke special, and it will point to the constant pool. That 5 is a point index to the constant pool of the class file. If you check the class file, before starting the code, there will be a tabular thing called constant pool, and this index will be a pointer to that constant. Okay. Now, we'll see whether all these existing bytecode can match the requirement of a dynamic language. Before going further, we have to note 2 terminologies. One is called a receiver. In OOPS terminology, receiver means object, and second terminology is dispatch. Dispatch basically means at runtime, search the method and link into the call site. Now we will go through one by one for each instruction. For invoke static, you don't need a receiver, because in OOPS terminology, receiver means object, and static method doesn't have any object associated with. Therefore, you don't need a receiver for invoke static. And dispatch also, for invoke static, you don't need any dispatch. Why? Because at compile time itself, it determines that at compile time itself, the compiler knows that which static method it have to go. It's not dynamic. All static methods are, if you see the, all static methods are compile time itself, compiler knows which it has to go. Therefore, there is no need of a dispatch. And second is invoke virtual. Invoke virtual is an instance. Invoke virtual is a method, bytecode for calling instance method. Therefore, it need a receiver. The object will be the receiver. And it need a dispatching logic, because for the using polymorphism and all, using method table or virtual table, it have to search which method you have to call, and overloading is possible. Therefore, invokes virtual, you need a dispatching logic. And same in the case with invoke interface. You need a receiver for invoke interface, and the same logic, dispatching also required, because it's possible for overloading and all. Therefore, you have to go via method table or V table to search the method. And the fourth one is called invoke special, which we used to call private method or super or constructor. For invoke special also, we have a receiver, because, and there is no dispatching logic, because it's again private method, constructor, everything is determined at the compile time. There is no overloading happening. Therefore, you don't need a dispatching logic for invoke special. Okay. Now, the problem with the dynamic languages, may or may not have a receiver. I mean, some languages doesn't have the concept of object orientation itself. Therefore, they don't have a receiver. Since they don't have the receiver, they may or may not have the dispatching logic. Therefore, our existing bytecodes will not fit for the dynamic languages. Therefore, this dynamic language compiler implementers have to do some workaround to work on JVM. And basically, this workaround or this simulation causes cost, performance overhead for the non-Java languages to run on JVM. Before going further details, I can take questions if you have. I mean, whether the receiver dispatch concept is understood, and why invoke dynamic was really required, what were the shortcomings of the existing bytecodes? Okay. 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 Two, since existing bytecodes have shortcomings, in 2005, The OpenJDK started new project as part of a DaVinci machine project. There is a project for all the new, there is a project called DaVinci machine project. It's basically started for creating new new language level features. The project aim is to introduce new Java new language level features. It started in 2005. It started as a JSR 292 to support dynamically typed languages, and it completed in 2011, and it released as part of JDK 7. The two key features of this JSR 292 was it introduced a new bytecode called invokedynamic, and apart from this, it introduced a new unit of behavior called method handle. And in the rest of the talk, we'll go details about both invoke dynamic and method handle. Invoke dynamic, it's a 5-byte instruction. The first byte will be an opcode, and second and third byte will be a index to the constant pool. As usual, as we saw in other invoke calls, the second and third byte will be a index to a constant pool. The fourth and fifth byte are currently unused. It's kind of kept for a futuristic purpose. And the key features of invoke dynamic is it doesn't require any receiver, and it can have a custom dispatching under user control, and the call set can be relinked dynamically. I will go through what it really means later, but the first two things are the important ones. It doesn't require any receiver, and it have a custom dispatching, and that too under user control. Rest all the method doesn't have a custom dispatching, and whatever dispatching was happening, it was happening under JVM control, not user control. Invoke dynamic, it will happen at user control. Now we will go through why. Okay. Now we will go through the process, how invoke dynamic is really happening. In your dynamic language, if we have a method called foo, and it accepts one int argument and a string argument. For example, in Python, if you have a call like foo one of string A, the equivalent bytecode instruction will be invoke dynamic, and there will be a pointer to a method called bootstrap method, and then foo and the arguments whichever you pass. This point is called a dynamic call site. I mean, the point where the method invocation happened is called dynamic call site, and the equivalent representation of that call in bytecode will be in this format: invoke dynamic, then it will point, second thing will be a pointer to a bootstrap method, and method name and the argument which you passed at the. The process of bootstrapping means linking this dynamic call site to a method. That process name is called bootstrapping, and it's a one-time activity. That is the important thing you had to notice. It's a one-time activity. It will link to a method only one time. As long as you are not changing the method, you can change the argument. As long as the method argument types are not changing, the relinking will not happening, and the bootstrapping will happen only one time. Now, this invoke dynamic instruction call site will call a method called bootstrap method. This, I will go in detail what is a bootstrap method, but this bootstrap method will return you a call site. The call site contains a method handle. In the coming slides, I will explain what is meant by method handle. And okay, basically invoke dynamic will call a bootstrap method. Bootstrap method will return you a call site. The call site will contain a method handle. This method handle will have, with method handle is equivalent to a pointer to a method. Therefore, after resolving the invoke dynamic instruction, you will get a method pointer at that place. That is the ultimate purpose of this thing. Any questions? Yeah.
Okay. Most of the dynamic languages, the type is determined at the runtime.
Yeah.
Okay. So, how do you do the typing here? Means. My question is, first, either how do you determine the type? For example, it can be an integer or it can be a long. How do you convert it at runtime?
See, at runtime, whatever argument you are passing, it will directly go to it will directly will come here.
Yes, it at comes here, and we don't know the type whether it's.
Yeah, you know, no. This is a runtime. At runtime, see, this thing is happening at runtime. See, your equivalent, for example, Python have a call called foo of 1a. That means we have the type. You passed the type at that time. Understood?
Yes.
It's a call site. It's not the method definition site. If it's a method definition, for example, foo a comma b, it doesn't have the type. This is the call site. You are calling foo with 1 comma string 2. That means we have the type. Clear?
Because in some dynamic languages, even for example, it can be an int or it can be a long.
Yeah.
Based on the number that is passed.
Yeah.
So, which method gets called in that? Suppose I have two methods. One which takes an integer as an argument, the other takes as a long.
Mm-hmm.
And from my dynamic language, I pass a value, some number. Mm-hmm. It can be either an integer or a long.
Mm-hmm.
How does it determine?
Yeah. See, that will happen in bootstrap method. The bootstrap method will contain the logic. How will you determine that method? Okay. That I will come in the coming slides.
Okay.
Apart from that, any other questions? The bootstrap method is a method which will take minimum three arguments. First argument is called lookup. In the coming slide, I will say what is lookup. The second argument is a string argument. You can pass any value to this string. It can be a method name or it can be anything. JVM spec doesn't enforce you to. JVM spec doesn't tell you what it should be, but it should be a string. According to your implementation logic, you can pass whatever if you want. Most of the dynamic language will pass method name in string. The third one is called method type. This is the method type of the call site. For example, in our earlier example, we have a foo. Assume its return type is void. And it is taking a indy argument and a string argument, okay? Therefore, you have to pass this void, you have to pass in this format, return type followed by the argument type. Therefore, you have to pass a method type object, which will be basically a void followed by int comma string. You understood in your quick, you got clarified? Because whatever type you passed at the runtime, that type will pass to this bootstrap method. Okay. Now it's the bytecode generators, basically the dynamic languages compilers responsibility to link your Invokedynamic instruction to appropriate bootstrap method. Okay. Dynamic language implementers have to link whenever they see a dynamic code, they have to link it to the appropriate bootstrap method. It's their responsibility. It's not the user responsibility. Now, another thing which we have to notice here is, you can see an Invokedynamic instruction. As usual, JVM will try to resolve those things at JVM level. Since it's an Invokedynamic instruction, since it's special, what JVM will do is, JVM will do an up call to the user level method. Basically, whenever a call happening from a JVM to a user level, technically it's termed as an up call. Whenever Invokedynamic instruction sees, JVM will do an up call to a bootstrap method. The property about important thing about bootstrap method is this method is defined by the user. Therefore, further resolution logic will happen in bootstrap method. Therefore, the resolution in the end, you can see that it's happening under user control. Did everybody get what this slide really want to say? Okay. In the normal case, every invoke method will resolve at JVM level. For example, assume that it's an instance method. Okay. it will be a basically invoke virtual some foo 1, 2. Then what JVM actually do is, associated with every object, there will be a virtual table or method table. This JVM will go and search in the method table where this method is defined. Then it will get the pointer for that method. It will load the method and it will try to execute it. Okay. Here what will happen is, when it see an Invokedynamic instruction, it will do from the JVM itself, they will have a callback to the user level. They will call the bootstrap method and tell, basically it will tell bootstrap that, I mean, I don't know how to link it, you please link it. Okay. Is it clear? And then basically linking is happening at user control. Now, we'll see an example. It's a lambda expression for runnable. Lambda expression is the only thing which can produce an Invokedynamic using Java language. There is no other expression in Java language which can produce an Invokedynamic instruction. Clear? Okay. Because basically it evolved for a dynamic language, and there are some other bytecode generating tool which using which you can generate an Invokedynamic. And in Java 7, Java as such, if you compile any Java program, it can't generate any Invokedynamic. And in Java 8, when they introduce Lambda, Lambda will produce, if you compile a Lambda expression, you can see an Invokedynamic there. Okay. Now, if you see the bytecode, I am just putting the relevant bytecodes for this equivalent expression. If you see the bytecode of this particular statement, it will be a, see, you just check the in a constant pool section. Can I point it? Okay. It will be an Invokedynamic. And first argument, as usual, it will be a boot, it will point to a bootstrap thing. The second will be the name and type, like our foo and 1, 2. The second will point to a name and type. It will be basically the method name and the type. Okay. The first one will be a bootstrap method. It will point to a area in the constant pool itself called bootstrap methods. And this will point to the original bootstrap method. For lambda, it's the bootstrap method is this one. It's a static method. It's called metafactory. It's there in the lambda metafactory class. Did everybody understood the flow? If there is a lambda expression in this way, it will equivalently convert into this form. Invokedynamic, some index, another index. The first index will be a point to a bootstrap method. This bootstrap, in the end, it will finally solve it to a invoke static method. That static method is lambda metafactory dot metafactory. Okay. Then second arguments are the name and type in foo, 1, 2. That name and type will resolve to runnable. Since it's a runnable, it will resolve to run and runnable. Does the example, any clarification is required? Okay. I talked here and there about some term called method handle. And okay, we'll see what really mean by a method handle. Method handle is basically a point, even though names are just method, it can point to method, constructors, and field. Basically, you can consider it as a function point. I mean, basically, it's a pointer equivalent of C++. Method handle is a pointer equivalent of C++, which can point to methods, constructors, and fields. Okay. Now we'll see what is this method handle. Okay. Before going further details about method handle, we saw here that every bootstrap method first argument will be a lookup object. We'll see what it really meant, lookup object. Lookup object is an object which contains the access permission. It will get clear when I'm showing an example. The lookup object is used to create a method handle, and there are two kinds of method lookup object. One is public, which will have the public access. Another one is called normal lookup, which will have the both public access and private access. By an example, you will understand it. I know from the phrases you didn't understand anything, but I'll show you an example and we'll see one. This is the way you are creating a method handle. First, you have to call a method handles.public lookup. Basically, assume that you want to call a value of method in the string class. We'll see how we can call it, okay, using method handle. First, you have, since value of is a public class, you have to create a, you can create a public lookup using method handles.public lookup. It will create a lookup. Then value of is a static method. Therefore, you have to call a lookup.findStatic. If it's a instance method, you should call findVirtual. If it's a private method, you should call findSpecial. I mean, all the equivalent logic you can find here also. If it's a static method, since it's a static method, you have to call lookup.findStatic. And you are searching the value of method in string.class. Therefore, you have to specify the class name first, string.class. Then the method name, value of. Then you have to specify the type. This value of will take char as an argument and it will return string. Therefore, you have to specify the method method type in this way. First, you have to specify the return type. Then you have to specify the argument. Now, once you have a method handle, you can call the method using basically two methods are there. Here I used invokeExcite. You can call method handle.invokeExcite, and you can pass the argument here. This thing is equivalent to calling a string.value of and passing C. Does this thing not clear? Basically, method handle is a function pointer, function or field pointer, and you can use those things to invoke. What is? Okay.
Java as a language or JVM as a platform.
Because?
Do not provide as such. And what is Invokedynamic and its related semantics is able to make that linkage possible. I think discussion on that front will really help.
Yeah, that's okay. I think I covered that thing already anyway. Okay. First, okay. One thing was more the existing bytecodes require some receiver and dispatching logic. Okay. And the dispatching logic was entirely under JVM control. Okay. Understood? Since you are getting the type at runtime, see, ideally, assume that there is no Invokedynamic. And if you are calling a foo of 1,2 in a dynamic language, as an implementer, the name way which I can assume is, okay, foo is a method which will take two arguments. Then I will have a switch case. If the first argument is int, call foo, which will take an int. If the second argument is string, I mean, you understood now. That is the name way of implementing it. Okay.
So first of all, are we talking about intra-language invocation or say, let's take an example of a Ruby. Are we talking about a Ruby method invoking another Ruby method or a Java method invoking a Ruby method?
A Ruby method invoking a Ruby method, but that Ruby will run on top of JVM. Understood, no?
basically a
you will write a Ruby code only, but it's not the normal Ruby, it's called JRuby. There you can access the Java libraries and Java packages. Okay.
So basically a Ruby code which is converted to Java byte code,
Java byte
and
code,
attempting to invoke another Ruby method which is again converted to Java byte codes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Exactly.
Is the fact that today you have a lot of different languages, Kotlin, Ruby, whatever. I mean, some of these can run on JVM. How is it possible, or how is it made to run in a more efficient manner, is what he's trying to tell. By Invokedynamic, I think that's.
Any other question? Okay. Okay, then we'll continue the discussion about method handles. Yeah, we reached here. Method handle is used to invoke. A method handle is in there, it's like kind of a function pointer using which you can call methods. And this is the way of one way of calling it. And there are actually two ways of calling it. First one is called invoke exact, and second one is called invoke or invoke generic. Invoke exact means the type should match exactly. I mean, if the value of, assume that there is another method which will take integer object, and if you are passing int, and if you are trying to do a invoke exact on that method, it will throw a wrong method type exception. If it's invoke exact, the type should match exactly, and if it's invoke, there this kind of type mismatch is allowed. Basically, they can do boxing, unboxing, and casting. And for example, if you are calling a method which talk integer, and if you are passing an int, if you are calling a method dot invoke, it will work because it will box it and cast it. And if that also not working, it will throw a wrong method type exception. We'll see the importance of lookup. I just mentioned the lookup. I didn't clearly specify what it really meant. For example, check a class B, which can take a private method, which have a private method, and there is another class A, and you are trying to create a method handle of private method of B. There is a private method. In A, you are trying to create a method handle for private method of B. If you write this code, it will throw an illegal access exception. Why it's throwing an illegal access exception is because you don't have the permission of calling a private method of B from A. Why it's happening is, if you call a method handles dot lookup, what it will give you, it will give you a, and okay, if you call a method handles dot lookup, that lookup object will not have the access to call the private methods of B, because only B will have the access to call the private methods of B. Okay, therefore you try to do a lookup for a private method here, it will throw an illegal access exception. Is it clear why lookup is important? Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. You can do that. See, for example, if I have a public method, if I have public field called lookup, and in B, the first statement is public lookup equal to method handle dot lookup. And then in A, you can do A dot lookup, and you can call the private methods of B. Therefore, it's the responsibility of the individual class to share the lookup object or method handle to trusted parties. Is it clear why lookup, what's happening with lookup, what will not happen with lookup? Okay. See, now we'll go, if you go back to our earlier flow, there was a dynamic call set. That dynamic call set was, okay. I think my time is almost out, therefore, yeah, I will quickly go through it. There was a dynamic call set. That dynamic call set was calling a bootstrap method. And this bootstrap method will take three arguments. One is lookup, another thing some string, and another thing method type. And since now you understood that if you have a lookup and you know the type and the name of the method, you can create a method handle out of it. Okay. Therefore, in the bootstrap method, you will have a logic based on the, because now the thing will get interesting. See, now everything is happening at the runtime. At runtime, you will get the type. Maybe it's a, even it's a dynamic language. At runtime, you will get the type. That type will pass to the bootstrap method. Then JVM will pass the lookup object to that bootstrap method. Since JVM is passing you the lookup object, JVM know whether the current context have the access permission or not. Is it clear? Since if you, okay, now if you get the lookup and the method type and you know the name, you can create a method handle out of it. And you can just return the method handle. And using this method handle, you can call it. Understood? That's the high level flow. Now, why, okay, well, we'll see the advantage of it. One important thing is, in reflection, what we see is every time you are invoking, it was going via access check. Because reflection is like that. I mean, you can call a method from anywhere and therefore access check is necessary. Okay. Now, in method handling, this access check will happen only during the creation. Because using lookup, it will check the access check and it will say whether do you have the right to create a method handle. If you have a create, if you have the right to create a method handle, you will create it. Now, since once you create a method handle, you don't need for no more access check is required. Because if you can create a method handle means we have the access. Once we have the access, you don't need to waste time on again doing an access check. That's the one of the advantage of method handle. Second thing is signature polymorphism. Since I can see so many confused faces and not completely going what is signature polymorphism. Basically what it will do is, if you have a, if your method is signature polymorphic method, how you can make a method signature polymorphic? In Java 7, they introduce a new annotation called polymorphic signature. It's kind of private thing, normal user can't use thing only, it's allowed only in the java.lang packages, Java libraries basically. If the method is a signature polymorphic method, then what will happen is, see, for example, assume that the method is not a signature polymorphic method. And invoke excite is a normal method which take a var x of object. Then if you're doing a call here, the type, if you check the type, it will be basically an integer and string. Okay? No, if it's a normal method, invoke exact is accepting a array of objects, and you are passing a int and string. Basically what it will do a boxing, and it will try to call the method. Okay? This is the normal case. If the method is polymorphic signature, if the method is annotated with this one, what it will do is, it will not do the boxing. It will just, whatever argument it's getting, it will just pass through it. And as long as our method handle is pointing to a method which accept an int, which accept an int and string, it will work fine. by this way, I mean, you don't have to do no more boxing, unboxing, and it reduce because of this thing. Otherwise, if you are doing a lot of boxing and unboxing, there will be so many garbage collectible objects lying around there just for this conversion. Since the method is polymorphic, signature polymorphic, compiler knows that, basically compiler assume that in then while executing, JVM will take care of this thing. I don't have to mind about it. I mean, whatever object I am getting, I will just pass through it. In the end, if the method handler is not pointing to the right method, just throw an exception. No. Yeah, exactly. But one slight difference is there. First, it will try to do a exact match. If it's an invoke, first it will try to do an invoke, exact match. If that exact match is not happening, then only it will do a boxing and unboxing. Therefore, even if you are using invoke and the method you are passing is a correct method, there's no need of boxing. Understood? As long as you can do an invoke exact using invoke, you're fine with it. This is other casting. Understood? If in the worst case, you can't do a casting and uncasting, if it's an invoke, it will do the boxing and box. Invoke exact will never do that. Therefore, it's depend upon you. If you're okay with the invoke, you can live with it. Otherwise, if you want invoke exact, you can do it. And final thing is call site. Basically, see, if you check the flow, it was something like this. Invoke, there is a dynamic call site. It will call a bootstrap method. Bootstrap method will return an object called call site. Call site contains basically method handles. Okay. And we covered almost all of it. Now only thing left is call site. What call site is really do is basically call site is a wrapper object for method handle. Call site will have a field called target, and this target will contain the method handle. And the advantage of the call site is, assume that you are calling some 100 times foo, method foo with integer and string. And late in the 101 time, you decided that, no, instead of int, I will call a string. Okay. At that time, what will really happen is, it will not go through the bootstrapping process. Instead of that thing, what it will do is, it will create a it will try to create a method handle for a string, and in the call site, it will just change the target. Roughly, it's maybe I know it's kind of confusing, but basically, since bootstrapping is a heavy process, that thing will happen only once. And if you need to really relink to a different method, at the runtime, you have to just change the call site target. You don't have to go via bootstrapping this. Now, another advantage of call site is, once you resolve the invoke dynamic, and if you check the method table, basically, see, this is the way usually a method instruction is executing. It will check the, it will see it's a method instruction. Then it will go into the constant pool cache entry, and it will check whether this instruction is already linked to a method or not. If it's linked, it will use it from there. If it's not, then it will try to resolve it and put it there. Since once you get the call site, you can put the call site in that constant pool table. Once it is there, it's entirely under JIT control. As long as the call site is not changing, JIT can go do an inlining optimization also. JIT's something like 100 times it calls the same method end with string. Then JIT, instead of putting a call site there, what it will do is it directly inline the method here and directly call it. It's kind of basically what it is doing is this call site is kind of basically transparent to JIT, and it can do the optimization better than if a wrapper layer is there. And this is the end, actually. This is a summary. There will be a dynamic call set. This dynamic call set will call a bootstrap method. you have to pass lookup and method type to this bootstrap method. And this bootstrap method will return you a call set which containing method handle. And these things internally solve all the problems of reflection which we talked earlier. Every invocation doesn't require an access check. Method argument doesn't need an boxing or unboxing as long as you are invoking with the correct type. And third thing is, it's not a black box to JVM anymore. Call site is transparent to JVM, and it can do the inlining as long as it can do the optimization. And I can see a lot of confusing face. Since it's a hard topic, I know it's assumed that it will be that. Yeah. Yeah. You know, it will create a new method handle. At that time, again, the access check will happen. I mean, access check is happening at the creation of the method handle. If you have the access, you are able to create it and you can. Any more questions? Then I'm done.